supporting you to take, and whoever has facilitated budget behind the scenes, whatever masjid affiliated with, and that we should not take that as a personal thing that it's only this masjid or this masjid as this pretext or this understanding of this belief. Whoever tried to work for the betterment of the proper orthodox understanding of Islam and to deliver the message and to save our youth from many of the corruption of others, take them into a cultural path. Because we know the more that we travel up north, we find there's so much cultural practice. For me personally, it's as if I'm just walking around in my village. No offense to that, when I travel to some places, just I'm walking around in my own village. The same arguments, the same understanding, as we begin to lose our youth on a daily basis. People are still feuding about what type of masjid it is, whether he says Ya Rasulullah loud enough, whether he does enough zikr, whether his beard is long enough, whether his topi is big enough, or whatever it may be. Still debating about that, whilst we're losing our youth on a massive scale. On a massive scale, we're losing our youth and the problems that we're facing. But those people are instrumental in doing something, rather than looking at the crevices or some mistakes or something that don't relate to them, look at the goodness of who is trying to take the effort and to bring the message to the community and try to do something for the community, rather than to tarnish those individuals with something that you may perceive to be an interest to you. And the truth lies in the book of Allah and the Sunnah of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam.
We have a second question here, something to draw on the paper. Assalamu alaikum, Shaykh Barakallahu feek. Please can you advise how practically we can engage our young people to embrace Islam when the glitter of the dunya calls them away?
And here we find us, we find the exposure of many of the masajid have many facilities more than what we have. So obviously the youth facilities of the masajid, the youth centers, the sports facilities that you find to organize whatever it may be, sports clubs, football clubs, you find trekking, whatever it may be, all types of sports activities, paintballing, all to bring the youth inside. You don't necessarily have to preach to the youth. Create a wholesome environment whereby the youth are able to come and to enjoy themselves, and in that person they give them a reminder, help them with their homework, help them with their GCSEs, help them with their A-levels, create environments for the women that they have structured classes for them. All these environments, all these facilities that you already have, to begin to create that, to put the youth into that. Don't think that every time it needs to be a full-fledged lecture to attract people. Sometimes youth are not engaged in the lecture. To use the different skills and abilities to bring the people inside the community and to give them the reminder. Whoever tries, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will bless those in the effort, inshallah.
Hi, brother. Yes, you can ask.
Sometimes, you know, when you see the youth, some people tend to forget one day, once upon a time, it would be like, yeah, just a pair of jacket. And some people forget how to be the best people to engage with them. Sometimes
they're smoking and slightly, you have a corner, you feel like shouting, you feel like they're doing anything bad, and then they might not turn to you after that. If you talk to them nicely, they just move more open. What's the best way that you can guide them and tackle them?
The brothers
asking the question, sometimes we may see, and all of us have been young before, some people may see their Muslim brothers and sisters doing something haram. Should we be too lenient? Should we just be soft with them? Should we be harsh with them? Should we may push them away? We're too soft, they may walk all over us. So the brother said it's all to do with hikmah, that is the key element, wisdom at the end of the day. If you know that you've been instrumental in the sense of in your previous life, that you've been instrumental, influential in the past of person you were, you can walk in that community, you can stop them in what they're doing, and there'll be no repercussions, then that's the best thing to do. But if you know that you're not instrumental and what you go and say to them may lead to more harm, then the person should just really give them mild advice and walk away. It all depends on the type of delivery. There's some brothers who live many years of an evil lifestyle, a bad lifestyle, but well known inside the community. When they walk in, everybody around them stops what they're doing. Or they walk away. If that's the type of person this person may be, and that's something great, that's something good. But that person doesn't have that power and ability, you need to give advice and they walk away. It's not for us, as they say, to take the law into our own hands and become vigilantes and to begin to rape people. I know I may have hinted towards that. Sometimes I do feel like doing that, basing people's doors down and as I say, jacking their guns, taking away from them, walking away from them, and seeing what are you going to do to us. And some people have literally done that. Some people have cleaned up the communities and some people have moved away. Some Jamaican yardies have moved away from the area. Say, look, if you don't move away, go somewhere else, we will jack your drums. We'll take every vermin from your face and tell you where to go. And some of them have moved away. But it's obviously not for Muslims to come and give it land to take the door into their own hands. We know that which creates more harm than good is a Muslim Islamic principle. Just stay away from it. But like I said, if your words can have an effect upon a person and just your attire being there makes people give up these actions, then alhamdulillah. If it leads them to something more harmful, then just give advice and walk away, inshallah. The brother asked the question that the brother was intoxicated, still offering his prayers. maybe it could be based upon any ayah of Quran, ya ayyuhalladhina amanu la taqrabus salata wa antum sukara hatta ta'lamu ma taqulun. Oh, you believe, don't come to this prayer while in a state of drunkenness until you know what you're saying. So he may think that he's not really drunk, so he's offering his prayer. But if a person is in a state of any type of alcohol or intoxication that we find, then that person's prayer will not be accepted. That does not mean that they do not offer their prayer. For 40 days, the person's reward is lifted. That does not mean that they abandon the prayer. The cultural concept we find in our culture that we find, which is predominantly in our culture, that when we commit a sin, we think, well, there's no point in me reading the mass, because I've done a guna, so leave salah. No, that's a wrong concept. Your sin is a sin. Your prayer is the prayer. So when you commit a sin, we all commit sins. So leave the sin on one side and still offer your prayers. Still do your obligatory action. That needs to be instilled within our culture. Because many of us think that, well, I've missed one prayer, maybe I've missed the next prayer, I've done this haram, I may have not bothered doing this, I may have skipped juma, I may have skipped this. No. So whatever the sin is, that's right, the person should not be praying if they're in a state of intoxication. You should wait until they become sober, become clear, and then repeat the prayer and offer the prayer. That does not become an excuse that someone's saying, oh, he was drunk and he was praying, so what's the point in praying? He may still have some fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He may still have some fear that he's trying to offer his prayer. Even that prayer may be incorrect, we can only advise him, try to offer the prayer wise in a good state, inshallah.
One brother has asked a question here. There is love, disunity amongst the Muslim community. Can you give us some advice on how to unite, or some advice on...
And obviously what can we do if people don't want to gather, don't want to unite for their own personal interest at the time? There's a lot of political cloud around us, that people will have a political interest in what they want to do. The way of a Muslim woman, أَحْسَنُ قَوْلًا مِمَّنْ دَعَى إِلَى اللَّهِ وَعَمِلَ صَالِحًا وَقَالَ إِنَّنِي مِنَ الْمُسْلِمِينَ. The way of a Muslim is only to call to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to step up with righteous action. And those people who are sincere, who want to be unity, to be based upon the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That is the essence of unity. If people have political agendas, or have other agendas, or other people who hold fast to, then all people will not be able to unite. The platform of unity is clear. Anybody can join that platform. It does not need to be built a new platform. The platform is clear. Whoever wants to come from that platform will come from that platform. Whoever has their own personal interest at stake, or their personal interest that they're worried about, then they will begin to diverse away. Islam is not here about who should be in charge, who should be governing, who should be the plain person. No. That's not what Islam is all about. إِنَّ الْأَرْضَ لِلَّهِ يُرِثُهَا مَنْ يَشَاءُ مِنْ عِبَادِهِ وَالْعَاقِبَةُ لِلْمُتَّقِينَ. This earth belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives dominance and inheritance from whoever he wants. And even a Muslim is dominant, the akhirah is the best place for the muttaqoon, for the pious individuals. Too many of our Muslim fractions and our grouping associations are seeking power, are seeking glory, are seeking governance, are seeking authority. Every masjid goes, what is the debate about? I should be in charge, or our family should be in charge, we didn't get voted, they got voted to power, whatever it may be. In general, 80 to 90% of our masjid, that's what they're brawling about who should be in charge. What difference does it make who should be in charge? Are you doing work for the community? Are you doing the things that you've been told to do for the community? Are you carrying out that trust? If you're not carrying out that trust, then you should be questioned. We have now at the moment any fraud in masjids taking place, massive amount of money that's being taken away, that's been invested in personal interest, whatever it may be, people being taken to court, whatever it may be, people complaining about the police coming by the masjid, dogs coming by the masjid, whatever it may be. Who's to blame for that? Yourselves. Yourselves are to blame for that. That are you serving the interest of Islam, or are you serving the interest of your own self? So those people want to seek in unity, want to seek the true understanding of Quran and Sunnah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will guide those people, show the people the correct path, and that is what we want to begin and bring our basis back upon, that understanding of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, give us that tawfiq and that ability. Wallahu ta'ala.
Thank you very much. Wa la ilaha illallah.